Wonderful and great to be here, and thanks for that nice introduction. And funny talking about, because I do speak quite frequently to garden clubs and master garden groups. In fact, I was in Wisconsin Rapids last weekend at a very neat, Wood County. I was at the Wood County Master Gardener Public Spring Fling, and had wonderful crowds there. And garden clubs, I've been gardening for 30 years, and the best thing that I did, the number one thing that I did when I became a new gardener was join, in my case, it was the Minnesota State Horticultural Society, but you have equivalents here, and basically that's just a giant garden club, and I joined my local garden club, and I would say that was easily the best thing that I did. And I also started reading what at the time was called Minnesota Horticulturist and is now called Northern Gardener. Anybody subscribe to Northern Gardener? Very good. Thank you. That is a wonderful magazine. I should have brought a copy with me to hold up at this point, but I write for the magazine. I write the, it comes out 6 times a year, and I write the bi-monthly, it's in every issue, the On Design column. So I write about landscape design. It's a wonderful magazine, award-winning, full color, the only magazine really designed just for us hardy northern gardeners. So I always throw that plug out. And the talk here today, really, I'll tell you how this talk came to be. It really goes back to my early days as a garden scout, when I was scouting primarily for better homes and gardens. And the job of a garden scout, this is by no means a full-time job, this is just something they actually emailed me, they approached me to see if I was interested. And all I'm doing is I'm traveling around the Twin Cities, when I can think of it, going on garden tours, sometimes just stopping as I see a glimpse of something as I'm driving around. And I'm trying to find really, really good residential properties, good landscapes, preferably done by the homeowner, that might be of a high enough quality to be included in the pages of Better Homes and Gardens. I also scouted for other magazines as well. And when I would have 10, 11, 12 gardens selected, I would get a hold of my editor, and he would fly up from Des Moines, Meredith Publishing, Des Moines, Iowa. They published Better Homes and a bunch of other magazines. And I would pick him up at the airport early in the morning. He would take one of the early flights, and we would zip around the Twin Cities, and I would have them in some order that made sense, and we would go on this garden tour. And it was interesting because sometimes we would pull up to a property that I had selected, and he would look out the window and he would go, is the backyard anything dramatically different? And I go, well, no, it's all, and he would say, let's go to the next one. And then sometimes we would pull up and he would hop out of the truck and we'd be there for 45 minutes. And he'd be shooting scouting shots, as they're called, and I would be shooting scouting shots. And, you know, the homeowner, of course, would know that we were coming, might be there, might come out, and Craig is chatting away with them. And I would have to kind of hustle him out of there. Because he would say, you know, when you get back in the truck, he goes, that's a beauty. That one has potential. And the thing to remember here is I don't get paid a dime unless one of my gardens gets into the magazine. That's how you're paid as a scout. I was lucky, too, because I was also writing for the magazine. So it was nice for me because I would get not only paid per photograph, which is how they pay a garden scout. You ultimately get paid per photograph that appears in the magazine. But they would also hire me to write the article, so it was important that I got some things selected. So all the time, and during this process, I'm asking myself, what is Craig Black at the time, my editor, what is he seeing? You know, why can he glance? And oftentimes, this was in May. I mean, the gardens were, you know, the perennials were up and stuff was beginning to happen. But he was visualizing what this thing looked like in July, which is when all gardens are photographed for, you know, don't worry about that. You see these glorious gardens shot. Yeah, I don't care what magazine or in your own newspaper or it's some magazine with this incredible West Coast garden or it's some fabulous Philadelphia, you know, garden or a Wisconsin garden. They're all photographed on about July 10th, you know, at 6 o'clock in the morning, of course. You're shooting in very low light so that the colors pop. And you look at them and you go, oh my goodness, you know, how could anyone create something like that. Well, you don't realize that we got there at, I was there the day before, deadheading, cleaning things up. The photographer is there. We're racing to nurseries and buying blooming lilies in pots, and we're dropping them down into the dead spaces. And I'm girdling the grasses with that green stuff at the base and bringing them up. And then first thing in the morning, I'm washing all the stone to get it wet, and I'm shooting. And then the sun, just as the sun rises, click, 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 and we shoot these, and you look at them. It's fantasy. It's theater. You think, oh, how can that garden be so... At the end of August, the garden looks like hell, just like everybody else's garden. So that's just a little aside, but... So I started thinking, you know, what is it about this garden that lands in the magazine and gets me a paycheck versus this garden that Craig dismissed? So that was the origin of this talk. There are design secrets in place. I originally did it and I came up with 12, you know, just kind of that classic number. And I thought, boy, that's too long. And you know, I mean, you guys have a handout. You can see how sophisticated the handout is. You know, 12, I have to do a real handout, and that's a pain. So then I had it, I think, at one point down to about 8. But as this project evolved, as this topic evolved in my mind, I really did, honestly, and I think to the best benefit, break it down into 5 design secrets, 5 things. 5 principles, 5 elements that I see every time I look at a beautiful yard and garden. So we're going to run through them here this afternoon. The design secrets to a beautiful yard and garden. Think about gardens that you see in magazines as well as we go through this. Every time I see a really nice landscape, it has been visualized and designed so that the entire property, regardless of lot size, and sometimes smaller city lots are almost more difficult to do this than large suburban lots, it's always been visualized as a unified whole. So the first design secret is for you, the homeowner, visualize your yard as a unified whole. The mistake homeowners make is they think too small. They look out at their properties, and regardless of lot size, they break it down into little individual areas. I want to do something out here around the mailbox. I want to do something in that sunny part of my front yard against the neighbor's fence. I want to do some sort of ornamentation up by the front door. Thinking too small leads to projects like cutting circles in your yards and plunking something in it. We want to grow our plants right here. So again, we'll go out to where the driveway meets the street, we'll cut a circle, and boom, there's my annual garden. We create these little, what I call pocket gardens, these little unrelated, floating little elements of landscaping that hopscotch throughout the property. We circle trees with stuff, uniquely American landscape behavior. We have a tree in the landscape, we don't know what to do with it. The thing we should do is just a couple of things. A, leave it alone, but B, our neighbors have tree circles, so by golly, we're going to circle it with some type of ornamentation, bullet pavers, or we put concrete retaining wall blocks so we can plant it with, you know, daylilies or annuals, or we put boulders around it, thus completely annexing it from the landscape, particularly a tree out in a grass lawn. It now has been completely annexed. As you gaze at the lawn, there's no sense of continuity or flow. We have these little floating islands. But like I say, we see them, we get used to them. So we figure, well, this is landscaping. This is not landscaping, this is vandalism. we go to Menards, we buy the little red tombstone thingies, and we circle it through, and then we dump it full of white rock. I love it. White rock. I don't think white rock is indigenous to Earth. I think the aliens bring it in their spacecraft. I think it's the byproduct from some intergalactic mining exercise. And when they're done, they have to transport all of this byproduct, and they say to each other, hey, dump it on Earth, you know, the Earthlings spread it around their yards, you know, so they get rid of it in our landscape supply yards. If you have trees or mature trees in the landscape, go ahead and circle them, but you want to pull the bed lines, the concept lines, which we'll be talking about, swing those out and incorporate the trees into the design. This is a patio area, backyard. The bed flows from the patio, incorporates the tree. If you have a tree in the middle of the front yard and you want to do some landscaping, don't give it a little tree circle. Go ahead and think putting greens. Think the overhead views of the Masters that we saw this weekend. And create what's called an island bed, which is a larger bed that curves around the tree, you know, kidney-shaped putting green, pond, oval, swings away from the tree, and then comes back and completes the island bed. Now you have room to plant it with, you know, low shrubs, maybe perennials, tall grasses. It might be a nice place for a bird bath. You've eaten up some lawn and you've created what's known as an island bed. The key principle for visualizing your yard as a unified whole is the concept of the concept line. And in landscape design, concept lines are the lines that the eye sees and follows when it gazes at a landscape. Those are the concept lines, the lines that the eye sees and follows. Your house foundation is a concept line. Driveways are concept lines. Sidewalks are concept lines. Fences are always typically straight, prominent concept lines. But pathways are also concept lines, the things you control. Pathways, as well as the edging material you use to differentiate a planting area from turf grass. So we see the concept line, backyard concept line, broadly curving the concept line that I just showed you. The concept line, this slide is dropping out a little bit, but the bed on the side of the house swinging out here, it extends out 16 feet and curves back to the front of the garage. These are what we use to start to unify the landscape. Typically, you know, your typical good old suburbanization of America, 1950s, 60s, 70s, suburban lot, maybe it's a half acre, the house is plopped down in the middle. You got 95% turf grass. We never used to grow that high percentage of turf grass. When in the 20s, the 30s, the 40s, the majority of Americans lived in cities. We lived in smaller city lots. We had no more than 40, maybe 50% of our total property was devoted to turf grass. What happened was the 1950s, the great suburbanization of America, Americans fled the cities. Eau Claire is a city, but even the towns, the smaller towns, and we started creating the suburbs. And now all of a sudden you were a landowner. You could own quarter acre, half acre, 1 acre. We got sold on this concept that now that we're gentry, we surround our homes on all four sides with turf grass. So you have all this turf grass. The 70s landscaper came in, you know, maybe a 3 foot wide straight line foundation bed, little tutus of shrubs around your house. Now the property's nice. You got a nice, beautiful big pine or spruce in the backyard. Lovely big tree. Can't grow grass around it, but it's a keeper. Lovely oak in the back, 150-year-old oak, or a beautiful big red maple, and maybe a second tree along the side yard. Beautiful trees. You can't grow grass around them. You have difficulty knowing what to do. But we start gardening. So here we are, right again at the start. Cut the circle in the lawn, you know, boom, fill it up with zinnias or something. Equally dreadful. Now we're going to, a few years later, we're going to become perennial gardeners. So we eyeball that sunny spot against the communal fence, and boom, we board up our perennial garden up above the potter's clay that it turns out we have. We plant some shrubs. We run some privacy along the fence. We circle our light pole, that little black light pole that sits out in front of the stoop. Give it a little pole circle, you know. Everything I'm talking about is me. I am describing my process of becoming ultimately a landscape designer. I circled my first My first light pole with Red Hot Sally Salvia. With a little pole circle. Swing set arrives when children arrive. We put it in the backyard. That's a good place for it. Safety, security, that's a functional aspect of landscaping. But we drop it right into the grass, along with the bird bath, along with the bench, the wishing well. These little objets that rise up out of the lawn so that when we mow our lawn, we have to go back either with the weed whacker or the hand trimmer and trim around them. And we look at ourselves and look at our property over the years as we've done these little disjointed landscaping, and we ask ourselves, you know, why ain't it happening? What's the problem? Well, you're not visualizing as a unified whole. It is the concept line created by the edging material that differentiates turf grass from the patio or from the house or from the planting areas. That is what allows a landscape to flow and to exist in harmony from the front of the street, around the sides, all the way to the back. In smaller yards, a terrific trend is to have no grass, and I've done landscapes typically in St. Paul and Minneapolis City proper, although a few suburban jobs. There's no kids anymore, maybe a small grass area in the back for a dog, but we're basically eating up all the lawn and doing the whole thing, naturalizing it with small trees, shrubs, pathways, perennials. And this is where the pathways, as well as the curving swaths of the plant material, particularly hedge-type shrubs, they then become the concept lines in a landscape that has no turf grass. But if you look at them side by side, the lines are always there. You just need to go out and find it. I don't recommend to anyone going out and the books all tell you to get graph paper and plot your house and measure your house and put it down in and then plot your property line and then the trees, etc., shrubs, you have to measure them from two angles, two different measurements and put them in place. You know, is it going to be quarter-inch scale? Is it going to be eighth-inch scale? You know, did you go to school for this? What's going on here? I lay out an awful lot of landscapes for customers if lawn's in place or even if it isn't. I use nothing but 50 and 100-foot lengths of a good supple rope, good loose three-quarter-inch rope. Marine rope works really well, that tightly kind of braided stuff. Because it's limp. You can throw it. You can lay it down. You know, it'll make a beautiful, broad, curving line as you're defining things. You can use rubber hoses. You've probably read that. That's great advice. They must be rubber. They must be the burnt red or black, or now there are some green rubber hoses, but they have to be rubber. You can't use your old cast-off green plastic hoses because they don't give you a beautiful, sweeping line. So we go down and we say, all right, I can't grow grass around my spruce, but you know, I could, there are viburnums, maybe I could fill this with hydrangeas, I can drop it down, swing it up. Oh, remember, when you have that turf grass in your, all four sides of your lawn, sooner or later, and usually sooner, you've always got that shady side yard, you got the shady backyard, sometimes both, sometimes in the city or elsewhere, it's a shady front yard. So you've always got that area where the grass doesn't grow very well. And it's muddy when it rains, and it gets weedy because the grass can't create a healthy carpet. So that's where a shade garden goes. All right, I can't grow grass around the maple, so I'll push it into the concept line. Now I get to my shady problem spot, this whole area. I'm just going to put in a stepping stone pathway. Now I can plant a redbud or a pagoda dogwood, or if it were a city lot, maybe one of the smaller beautiful hydrangea tree forms that they have now, more of a shade, part shade, understory tree. I can fill this up with shade type shrubs, maybe, and perennials, maybe do a hosta glade or a woodland garden and a stepping stone. Then when I come back out to my hot, sunny area, remember our perennial garden, it's still there. It's just that it's the continuation of the concept line that allows a landscape to segue from a backyard and side yard shade area back into full sun. There's my perennial garden. Over here, you wanted a little garden at front. go ahead and drop your hose or your rope off your property line, swing it down, or let's go all the way up to the little crab apple that you planted or the little ornamental tree. It turned out that was a good idea. You did a good job on that one, but let's invite it into the party. These aren't giant beds. This could go 3 feet, bouncing out to 42 inches, going back to 3 feet, finish it off with a little boxwood hedge, colorful flower garden in front. You can run your bed line, your concept line, lay your hose. I do this all the time. I'll lay my ropes right across the driveway, curve it across the driveway, pick the bed up on the other side. The eye will see that concept line flow right through the driveway and get picked up on the other side, and now we can create an entryway. How many of you have houses where the front door and the garage door face the street? Okay. If you live at all in a suburban environment, if you're living in the city and you do have an attached garage or even an unattached that sits next to your house, maybe you've got a small front yard and your sidewalk comes off the front door and it runs directly to the city sidewalk or to the street. Typically, you guys, I bet a majority of you have a front door where the sidewalk comes off the front. Then it either turns to the right or it turns to the left and it goes to the driveway apron. That will always limit the width of that bed. And sometimes it's 18 inches or 2 feet or 3 feet. And it just isn't wide enough. So jump the sidewalk. Go ahead, this area, this the little light pole area, let's give it a landscape bed. Now I can put some shrubs in, a tall grass, maybe a nice little piece of decorative artwork. And when people walk to my front door, they enter into the landscape. Same thing here. Lovely tree out in the lawn. You know, leave it alone. Grass growing up to the trunk. If it's an evergreen and you haven't trimmed it up, don't get me started. If it's an evergreen with limbs down around the bottom, you know, you can certainly mulch that area because the limbs, you know, the tree is wide. But if it's a deciduous tree where it has a trunk coming up, seed it, you know, sod it, whatever. I find nothing wrong with a tree growing directly up from a grass lawn, even multiple trees, because as you look at that lawn, then it is one continuous flow. I can't mow around the roots, and it's a guy thing typically. Yeah, but the roots, you know, the roots get out there, and you can't mow tight up against the tree. Well, no. So you mow as tight as you can, and then when you're done mowing as tight as you can around that tree without hitting the roots, you buy one of these things, a hand grass scissors thing, and you walk out, and you go down on one knee. This is called gardening. You go down on one knee and you click more on the tree. It takes you 22 seconds. Or you create, you say, the kids are gone. I'll talk about the backyard in a minute. Or you say, hey, let's develop this. Let's create a concept line that mimics that bed and swings out here and incorporates the tree. And now I can plant this area and create, I can even come up, mimic the bed, and start to eat up that grass. Typically a landscape renovation, if you want to start incorporating this first principle, it's always going to include bouncing out the foundation beds on an older house. They're 3 feet, even 4 feet. You can't do anything with it. The straight line of the house dictates the design quite often in older landscapes. There are no straight lines in nature. I like to bounce these things out 4 feet, 5 feet. It depends on the height of the house. I'll go even farther out. If I'm landscaping a two-story house, particularly a brick starter mansion, a honker with a 30-foot roof, I'm hoping they didn't drop it in there in one of these developments where, you know, your the next house is 20 feet away. Because I want to get 10, 12 feet away from that house off towards the rear. I need to get small trees in off of the corners in the foundation bed of that house. Otherwise, you go by these developments, they look like a Monopoly hotel sitting, you know, on a Monopoly board. They are, as I say, dollhouses sitting on a pool table. You know, where's the nature? Where's the landscape? So I like to kick these out. If you like the natural style, bend it in as you move towards the middle and back, and then you notice how these beds wind out farther. They're deeper off of the rear corners than they are off of the front. That allows me to plant larger taller material off of those important rear corners, properly spaced from the house, so that as you look at the house from the street, these front foundation beds, you get the sense of the landscape flowing and then rising up around the bed. Remember my swing set? It's still there. But swing sets, dog kennels, compost bins, gazebos, fountains, bird baths, benches, these are better served pushed from the lawn area into the concept line. There's my child's play area. I could have put a sandbox in here. Now I can just mulch this area. I've made the backyard bigger. Now the kids actually have room to set up a volleyball net or throw a baseball around. Here, you know, instead of shrubs here, perfect spot for the compost bin. If that tree weren't there, that's where I'd put my gazebo with a stepping stone pathway, maybe from linking it to the patio. You might say, oh, a perfect place for a bench, or maybe the bench goes there. Oh, no, maybe the bench goes there. The bird bath, you'll see a perfect spot for it. The piece of artwork, the sculpture. These little areas will always appear to your eye after you design the big area as we visualize our yard as a unified whole. Beautiful little landscape in St. Paul. This is featured in Better Homes and Gardens. I didn't do this landscape. It's not one of mine. A friend of mine, St. Paul landscaper, did it. You know, 1920s, St. Paul House, Como area, State Fairgrounds, had the old 30-inch wide foundation bed. 1920s, 1930s, 1940s, landscapers, they would measure 30 inches. And if, when I'm doing a renovation on an older city home in the Twin Cities that's never been touched, I don't even have to take my tape measure out. I can glance at it. It's 30 inches. That's what they did. Just enough for a little tight tutu of yews, you know, the favorite plant. So this had a tight, straight-line foundation bed. Came right off there. Well, they tore all the plants out. They pushed the bed out, and this is a key trick, if you have steps or a stoop coming off your front door, you always need to push the bed out at least to the front of the first step. Because you see what happened before, the bed line came right off here, didn't it? 90-degree angle. And the grass ran all the way up to here, 90-degree angle. Now the concept line continues across the whole house. So they pulled that bed well out in front. Now you can plant an ornamental clump tree. Perennials. They tore up the plain gray straight concrete, too narrow, that ran straight to the city sidewalk, and the landscaper installed a very nice, kind of loses it here in this room, but this is a nice paver, concrete, curving paver pathway. Then notice where the pathway narrows and it goes around to the side door, and then this walkway proceeds to a very, very polite, cool backyard. They jumped the sidewalk. The sidewalk was limiting the depth of this bed, particularly in relation to this bed. So now the concept line, rather than just run turf grass up here, the concept line swings here, and they extended this perennial point out, jumping the sidewalk so that as you enter to go into the side yard, you enter into the landscape. It balances the overall design. Certainly plenty uses of turf grass. But just a very, very good, charming foundation planting based on unity and the unified whole. I tend to look at lawn. I'm not one of these anti-lawn guys. I mean, lawn has, to me, it serves two functions. There's a utilitarian function. It's great for child's play. And if children or grandchildren are in the procedure, dogs as well, a small dog area. It secondly has an aesthetic value. I try to minimize it in designs. I think the big problem is the overexposure of lawns in our landscaping. But it is a lush, when done properly, it's a lush flowing green. It gives us an opening. It gives me the opportunity to present space, clear space from where you're standing to the view over there. If it's all shrubs, you know, you gotta be up, how can I create something that looks pretty as you turn the corner? But I tend to look at lawn as water. Lawn is the lake. Lawn is the pond. Lawn is the river. Lawn is the stream. It's always curving. It's always flowing. And the shoreline of this lawn water is the landscaping. All right, so number one was visualize your yard as a unified whole. Number two, make ample use of trees and shrubs. They kind of are interrelated. This is what I'm talking about. We're starting to landscape now and create houses in the suburbs, and we're 95, 99% lawn. This is the kind of stuff I deal with all the time when I'm in developments, getting ready to land. This is what the builder leads me. Well, you have to put an emphasis on small trees and shrubs. When I started gardening 30 years ago, I spent 10 years in love with perennials. And I've spent 30 years in love with perennials. I love perennials. But the first 10 years, perennials to me were the beginning, be-all and end-all of gardening. And they certainly are wonderful. And they certainly, of course, have their place in landscape design. But luckily, at one point, a switch flipped. And I realized that what we're not using enough of, and what really is the foundation and the genesis of truly beautiful landscapes, is ample use of small trees and shrubs, particularly in our foundation beds around the house. Let's get some height, some color, some form in wider beds around our homes. Landscape of mine, this was new home construction, this is the backyard, in Greenfield, Minnesota. Ample use of small trees, shrubs, my concept line swinging through here. Again, this is the garage. This is the side yard. Why do you have to put even a 6-foot bed through here? When if there's enough property, you can swing that thing out 20 feet and plant a river clump birch or any number of the beautiful new pyramidal pines, hemlocks, firs. Even some narrower forms of spruce that can be planted 10 feet from a house and grow up to do what? To create a height and a canopy or a evergreen structure that exceeds the roof line and starts to drop the house down in scale. And the cool thing, once you start exploring the world of small trees and shrubs, is the evergreen shrubs, which are essential to us here in the north. Too many of us, I do a talk called Top 10 Gardening Blunders, and one of the blunders in it is we forget about winter. You know, we forget. You know, it's how much color, who has something in bloom in their yard? Crocus?
Yeah.
Pretty good, aren't I? It's May, it's April something. You know, May is when we start to see the bud break, you know, the forsythia, maybe the end of April in some springs. But so May, June, July, August, September, October, I'm only up to 6. What happens in November? You know, name the November blooming perennials or shrubs. No. We landscape for 6 months out of the year is when we get the deciduous foliage color and any type of discernible bloom. So what is it important to rely on? The evergreens, and particularly the dwarf evergreens. The most overused dwarf evergreen in the history of landscaping, the dwarf globe blue spruce. And why not? They're gorgeous. They're blue 365 days out of the year. You plant a small one in your 20s, you won't live long enough to see it hit 6 feet. It is a dwarf tree. The wonderful junipers, the spreading junipers and the gold-tipped junipers. Another one of my favorite dwarf trees, that's the blue shag white pine. Dwarf white pine. You might live long enough to see it hit 6 feet. By 7 feet wide, it just develops this fabulous cloud-like shape. Camassiparis, available to us here. Probably available at your better Eau Claire nurseries. We certainly sell a lot of them. If any of them you do ever make an annual trek over to Gerton's, not to disparage your Wisconsin nurseries, I just don't know what's available to you. Maybe maybe you got the coolest nurseries in the world, and you probably should. Wisconsin's very good when it comes to the plant industry. But, you know, Gerdens will sell you microbiata. No, not microbiata, Camassiparis, King's Gold. It's an Evergold. It's gold 365 days out of the year. If you let the leaders grow each year, and it just has this Rastafarian kind of a dreadlock foliage to it. And it'll send up a couple of leaders every year. And if you let the leaders grow in, you know, 8-10 years, it turns into about a 5-foot, you know, cousin it from the, remember the Adams family? It's a blonde cousin it. If you cut off the leaders or just let them grow a little bit, it just turns into this 3-foot mounding by 4-foot or even 5-foot wide, 365 day out of the year. Evergold, question.
What did you call that?
That is a Camassiparis, King's Gold. Camassiparis, C-H-A-M-A-E-C-Y, Paris. Now perennials start to make sense. Once we create the structure, and in cases where there are no lawn, aid in the development of concept lines with the shrub plantings and small trees and shrubs, now the perennials start making sense. I look at perennials as throw pillows. I look at them as dashes. Yes, you can design your garden so that there is one area where they collude and combine to create an area of pure perennial garden or an area of pure cottage garden. But I look at them more as the colorful tie on a nice, you know, wool pinstripe navy blue suit, or the scarf in a or the accessories in a woman's outfit. And we begin to have the ability to soften corners around the house. The wonderful magnolias that are available to us, and there are so many magnificent small and mid-sized magnolias. That's Ricky in a planting at a client's of mine in Golden Valley after blooming and after the foliage had emerged. But just this lovely, irregular, rounding, blousy shape in order to break up those harsh, vertical, horizontal lines. And again, if we get seduced by color, and I'll be talking about this at the end of the talk. What's color? Shrubs are color. If you want color in the landscape, Camassiparis, or arborvitae, yellow ribbon, amazing, just fantastic. A shot when I was at Bachman's, I was just getting out of my truck and I took a quick shot at one of my wholesale nurseries. Fothergilla, blue shadow. Don't worry, it's misdiagnosed. You look it up, Fothergilla, that's father with an O, Father. G-I-L-L-A, Fothergilla, and they should be available at good Wisconsin nurseries. They're sold in the Twin Cities. That's Blue Shadow, the only blue-leaf deciduous shrub you can grow. Part sun, full sun, as long as it doesn't get absolutely baked midday. Blue-leaf. The barberries, God bless them, I don't plant them anymore. I've joined the... I leave that slide up just because there are other alternatives that give you fabulous, fabulous reds, purples, yellows, blues, all sorts of colors in the shrub world. I joined the Japanese barberry boycott because they're turning to be invasive. And if it's flowers you're after, again, you got to get to know shrubs. A shot of one of my PJMs, PJM rhododendron. In one of my first gardens. I don't own that house anymore, but if you want flowers, you got to learn the world. And small trees, ornamental trees, your decorative trees. Things again, the magnolias in spring. Red buds. And of course, you know, crab apples, which we know so well. If you want flowers, you got to start exploring the world of small trees and shrubs and increasing their percentage of use throughout your landscape. And then, of course, with shrubs, you start getting into the fall foliage variation. A shot, again, of my house. Good old dwarf euonymus elatus, dwarf burning bush. Beautiful, stately green all summer long. I've got it planted next to a blue skyrocket juniper. There's a young, that's an old photo. Young little camassiparis. I have some macrobiata. Here's Uncle Fogey, weeping pine. And it all looks lovely, and then, boy, in the fall, bang, it stops traffic. Because now we've got a huge fothergilla, viburnum, the euonymuses, many, many more shrubs than that that have incredible fall foliage color. So, number one was visualize your yard as a unified whole. Number two, use ample amounts of small trees and shrubs. And number three, use natural materials in the landscape. What I was realizing Craig was doing quite often was he was rejecting what might be a yard with some cool plants and some good design, but there was too much plastic, too much concrete. Now, I have to tread delicately. Concrete block retaining materials, they came around in the 1960s. They were developed for corporate uses and for highway departments. And then the concrete industry said, hey, you know, they're cheap, they're inexpensive, they're flat. Homeowner can install them. Let's sell homeowners on the idea that this is a good product for your yard. In this case, two homeowners, apparently not on speaking terms. Now, I just, you know, and so we got, and again, you know, I mean, God bless you, I understand. There is a lot of times there is a financial, budgetary issue as we decide on stuff. It's less expensive than using stone, concrete retaining wall block. I just find that too much of it lends this air of a state penal facility to your yard. Instead of a celebration of all things natural. You can't do that with concrete. That's a wall of mine that I did last year in St. Paul in the right off of Grand. Funky little artsy neighborhood in St. Paul. The couple, they said, we want something no one's ever seen before. We want the funkiest stone wall you've ever seen. So I pitched them on the idea of six different types of stone. And there's the left of the stairway, and then here's how it proceeds. And we terraced it. Because what was it before? It was that 45-degree grass hill. If you've ever lived in a city, you know, you'll go block after block. The front yard's 5 feet above the sidewalk, and it's a grass, doggy, washed-out grass lawn that runs down. So we terraced it with two walls. You can't do that in concrete. Now, so that I don't offend, I've already offended half of you, but I realize there are budgetary concerns. And the concrete industry continues to get better. I mean, what have they started doing? They've started blending their products with natural aggregates. They're tumbling the products. I'm a big fan of concrete pavers, and I will install concrete pavers. I think a blended concrete paver driveway is probably the best you can go. If you want a good flat patio or entryway, I'll always consider concrete pavers with customers, depending on budget, because they're going to be cheaper than using natural stone. But I'm not saying you can't use concrete. If you do choose concrete, just get out to the suppliers and take a look at the newest generations of the various concrete products. They continue to get better every year. They can't ever match the permanence. I mean, you know, 20 years versus 2000. Or the power or the beauty of natural stone. This is the front yard. You see how you come up here? There's a pathway that starts here. Now there's no, this was all lawn. So this was all lawn. The only thing that remained in the landscape is the dwarf blue spruce, and that's an old one. That's a 50-year-old dwarf blue spruce. And a very cool hydrangea tree, which is also very mature. Everything else was lawn. And as you come up the stairways, you hit the entryway of a pathway. And I caught the neighbor out enjoying his coffee. So, this is a yellow-tipped juniper. So now the pathway, because there is no lawn anymore, we tore everything out, we replanted it, now you've got this very nice curving concept line that flows around the side and heads into the backyard. It's tough to do that in concrete. This was a house in Greenfield, Minnesota, far suburbs, 5-acre property, new home construction, zero landscaping, built into a hill. The hill slopes down here. So we got to hold this up. Well, you know, were the people interested in series after series of concrete retaining wall terracing? No, you got to do it in stone. I mean, there are just times you have to do it in stone. You can't take the easy way out. This homeowner, you're looking at about a third of a gorgeous little small city lot, northeast Minneapolis. We photographed this for Better Homes and Gardens years ago. I made good bucks on that one. This one ran for about 14 pages. The front, where it was terraced with cobblestone, the side yards, there was not a stitch of grass in it, northeast Minneapolis, the side yards, and then it flowed through a Japanese-style privacy fence into a backyard, of which you're getting a glimpse of one side of it, all natural products. I mean, there's no, you have to go out at night, you got to steal cobblestones. like this homeowner did. I didn't really steal them. The city was redoing streets, and there's a pile of them. So at 3 o'clock in the morning, it's perfectly all right to go. You got to purchase, you know, you might have to buy Mexican beach belts. You got to get a stone bench for this scenario. I have nothing against plastic patio furniture made out of recycled milk jugs. I was just at a show in Charlotte, South Carolina. No, I was at the St. Paul show, too, and the Charlotte show. Gorgeous stuff.
Squirrels eat it, though.
That's a new one. Didn't know that. I was looking at some beautiful stuff, and in the right setting, on a deck, you know, I don't have any problem, but you got to fly the stone bench into this equation, all right? Natural materials. The homeowner here, a little side yard, check this out, Mr. Baffin here. Completely done by the homeowner, this little stepping stone pathway that leads underneath the arbor into the most exquisite backyard you've ever seen. Did she go and get the perfectly round concrete little pebble top steppers and drop them down? No. She had to go put a new tarp in the back of the Lexus, drive to the landscape supply yard, and purchase probably Wisconsin Fond du Lac. I buy about 90% of. Oh, I forgot to mention that we have died and gone to heaven. Minnesota, you live in Minnesota, Wisconsin. You want to get into stone. So she had to go buy actual steppers, and you got to dig them in. Because they wobble, and you got to probably have some sand, and you might have to hit them with a rubber hammer, and it takes longer. But that's what you get. That's what seals the deal. Natural products. Natural stone. I try to impress upon my audiences, when you're landscaping your house, that's not one of mine. That's from a garden tour that appeared in Better Homes. That's a garden, that's a Crocus Hill area of St. Paul, where I have some clients. That is not one of them. Think in terms of plants and earth and organic mulch and stone and wood and iron and clay and water and fire. You just want this organic oomph to rise up from your even if it's decoratively painted, from your landscape. Homer, Alaska. I spoke in Homer, Alaska several years ago and went on some fabulous garden tours in Homer. And this property overlooking the large bay there, the ocean bay that swings in through Homer, and a beautiful arbor that the homeowners had built. But of course it was all natural materials and reflects the natural style and, you know, Alaska. for this little pathway that curves down, and it curves down here, and then it makes a sharp curve and disappears, and I started walking down to it, and I said, wow, is that ever cool? I said, because this is about 2 miles. And I said, how long did it take you to cut the pathway all the way down to the ocean? And they said, oh, no, it ends right around that corner. It just, it dead ends. They say, you walk 30 feet down farther, he said, you'll get eaten by a bear. So they don't actually cut it all the way through. But if you are in Homer, Alaska, and you have access to natural materials, what's wrong with using whale ribs as a decorative accent, as sculpture as you enter? Oh, the gardens in Alaska are incredible. I mean, you can't buy sunscreen. The fishermen don't wear sunscreen. You can't buy the stuff. They're growing hot. They're growing blue-leaved hostas out in full sun, and these things are huge. They're hookerar, huge. And their perennial geraniums are just on steroids because it's low intensity, but it's 20 hours a day. And very, very cool gardens. Okay, number one, we visualize our property as a unified whole. Number two, ample use of small trees and shrubs. Number three, use natural materials in the landscape. Number four, create focal points with garden accessories. It is the non-plant materials, the garden accessories that we choose and place throughout the landscape that customize and create a unique landscape. They reflect maybe our culture, or they reflect our heritage, or they just reflect our artistic sense. And these are the objects that make our landscape different from any other. And of course, I'm talking about number one, containers. Containers are really our perennials, but also containers I call the throw pillows of exterior design, and that's what they are. You fling them throughout the landscape. Don't just cluster them up tight around the house. That's fine. Steps and stoops and patios. But, you know, the bowl of impatience, or as long as you can grow impatience, that is, the bowl of colorful, an arrangement at the entranceway to a pathway. The backyard interrupting, a stand of shrubs with a pedestal and a lovely colorful arrangement. These are the dots and the dashes, the accessories that we use as we work our way around the landscape. Boulder outcroppings. If it's not a plant, it's an accessory. I consider boulder outcroppings a simple accessory that's available to you if you like the look. And I use a lot of boulder outcroppings. Depends on the location, depends on the neighborhood. But I just find that they give us, Canada Green, it's called, Emerald Green. It just gives us different colors and different textures with which to bounce off plants and to give us better allure to the property. Seating areas, benches, sofas. These are functional furniture pieces with which we now accessorize the landscape. They will always serve best pushed just into the concept line or further in within, but just a few various photos of benches and seating areas. That's my first bench I ever placed in my first landscape. Seating areas, simple accessories. Artwork, sculpture. You purchase art, you purchase sculpture for your home's interior. Now we purchase art and we can decorate our yards and landscapes with artwork and just some photos of various bits of art. In my travels, the oldest trick in the book, of course, the old patio barbecue done as a planter. Sometimes, you know, you buy the color's gone from this photo pretty well, but that's beautifully glazed, you know, just a beautiful container that doesn't have any plants in it. It's just a nice sculptural piece, sculptural addition, the use of sculpture and artwork. And then also a very effective, if you like it, it depends on location, but the concept of the garden ruin. I was on garden tours in the Pacific Northwest in the Seattle area, and beautiful home, private residence, and in the backyard it went down into a wooded area, and there was a pond, a natural pond there. And years before, the homeowner had taken a terracotta urn and kind of abandoned it on the shoreline. And as you're walking this little woodland path, you turn the corner, and that's the view that was presented to you, a very effective garden ruin, which is a simple form of garden accessory. So where are we? Visualize your yard as a unified whole. Use ample reliance on small trees and shrubs. Natural products. As economy dictates in the landscape, and then non-plant accessories to decorate and to make your make your landscape unique brings us all the way to the final of the five principles. Every time I look at a truly beautiful perennial garden, flower garden, landscape, front yard, backyard, full landscape, every time, plants are placed based on contrast between size, shape, and color of foliage. Color of bloom is a secondary concern. I will say it again. Color of bloom is a secondary concern. I would even call it tertiary. I would say contrast in foliage, color, size, shape, texture, contrast in plant form, number two, bloom color. I don't even worry about bloom color all that much, frankly, when I design. Perennials have leaves, if you're a perennial lover. Leaves have size, shape, texture, form. It is learning to place plants so that you achieve subtle or stark contrasts in the foliage as the eye moves from plant to plant and from section to section, that you will automatically elevate your gardens and your landscapes into higher and higher levels of beauty. Even when we're only dealing with perennials. I like bloom. Bloom's fine. Bloom often doesn't make up a majority of the entire visual weight of the perennial. Besides, the perennial's there all season. The bloom's there for 3 weeks. So the sedums, who grows heuchera? Coral bells. Yeah. Why? For the little, the little dig of it, the little red, pink dinghies that come down. No, I cut those off as they appear.
Yeah.
Why do we grow hostas? For the purple flower? No. See, we kind of get it. Why do we put coleus in containers? For the little dumb blue spike that you should be pinching off when it appears July 4th? No, we kind of get it. We just never quite have seen it all the way through. It's the foliage contrast, the stachys, the heucheras, the incredible sedums that are available now, purples, there's yellows, there's blues, there's red foliage, just in the perennial world. The euphorbias, the ferns, the upright grasses, the spreading, flowing grasses. It is learning to purchase and place plants so that we create portraits and tapestries of foliage contrast, that we truly begin to elevate our gardens. And then we start thinking about form. Now we're aware that there is pyramidal form, upright form, columnar form, spreading form, rounded form, tree trunks. The arborvitae here, the group spire arborvitae. Now we start realizing that there's another thing we can play with. We can play with the actual shape or form of the plants in our efforts to create more beautiful landscapes. Now, when things bloom, hallelujah, I don't mind having a plant. You know, I'll design garden. If you want to create a bloom color palette, that's fine. If you're doing a perennial garden, I want, you know, flowers that bloom in white and pink and blue and yellow, that's fine. But don't go out and buy white flowers, pink flowers, blue flowers, yellow flowers. You want the coolest perennial foliages you can find. Silver, blue, pinkish red, yellow, gold, variegated, light green, middle green, dark green, purple. You want the coolest foliages you can find that happen to bloom in your plant palette. Because, you know, again, how long did perennials bloom? 3 weeks. You know, the list of perennials that blooms longer than 3 weeks is about that long. If you're basing it all on, you know, oh, it's gorgeous when the tall phlox blooms, yeah, how does it look for 6 months or 5 months, 1 week when the tall phlox isn't in bloom? If you begin to place plants based on contrast in the foliages and the plant form, you will understand that you can create beautiful landscapes even when bloom is not present. So those are the five principles. You want to visualize your yard as a unified whole, ample use of small trees and shrubs, use natural materials in the landscape to the best your budget allows, accessorize your landscape with non-plant artifacts, and place your plants based on contrast between foliage and plant form. And if you do those five, you will always create a beautiful, beautiful landscape. Now, if you want to hang out with me, that's a shot of my backyard in Minnetonka, Minnesota. The Lake Minnetonka is No, that's a shot. How many have been there? I'm standing on the railing overlooking the, you've been to Butcher. I'm up a high railing. I'm looking down on the entrance to the famed Sunken Garden at Butchered Gardens, Vancouver Island, British Columbia. Lovely principles of what we're talking about. My website is renegadegardener.com, one of the oldest, most highly linked, independent, non-commercial gardening websites on the internet. We have a lot of fun there. I just updated it with a mammoth guide to organic gardening is the current. When you flip to it, there's always a current column. And then I update it every month. And then there's a bunch of fun clicks. Myth of the week, don't do that. There's one called Plant Spotlight. There's one called Top Pick, where I talk about garden products. There's a design button. You click on the design button, it unfolds nearly 20 years of articles, most of them with photos that I've written concerning landscape design. And you'll find one, if it's alphabetical, you'll find one on there called Design Secrets to a Beautiful Yard and Garden. Another one under the design button that there's a bunch of them, you should read them all. But there's one of the longest, most photo-filled articles on my website is under the design button on the homepage called Landscaping 101. A lot of good design articles there. And then there's a newer article from last year that a lot of people have commented. And they've got URLs on. You can copy them and email them around, the newer ones. Some of the old newspaper columns and stuff don't. But there's a one you should read, Why Beautiful Landscapes Are So Odd, that also covers these topics. Well, I've wrapped it up so that we have a little time for those who are interested in staying and asking questions. For those of you that have heard enough and it's time to go, I want to thank you so much. And on behalf of the library here, I want to thank you for spending some time with me this afternoon.
Thank you.
So if you got to go, go. If you have questions or you want some plant things, we can deal with those. Yes, sir.
What do you think about plant markers in your garden?
Well, plant markers in the garden, I don't have any objection to those. They aren't natural, but you know what? They're probably there because the person loves people to come over and see the garden, and they're getting so dang sick and tired of telling everyone what that is. If they're helpful, they're okay as long as you have the botanical Latin on it, as long as you got genus and species. I don't want it to say, you know, foam flower, well, you know, bachelor's buttons. As long as it's helping you learn the botanical genus and species and variety, I don't have a problem with those. It's probably, you know, a lot of people, the hosta nerds and the daylily nerds, they've got them all on their computer, you know, with little GPS maps, and, you know, so they don't have to put. I never did, you know, and I'm terrible. I never did plant. I would buy really beautiful hostas when I was in my hosta stage, and I would plant some hosta, and people would say, "Oh God, what's that one?" And I would just make it up. I'd go, "Oh, that's Oreo Marginato William Shatner. Yeah. And they'd go ahead and they'd write it down. Another question back there. Good question. She has a lot of shade in her yard. What kind of flowering shrubs? I have a talk on that computer that I give, and if I'm ever back here, if they invite me again, I have a talk called Plant and Design Tips for Shady Spaces. Yeah, more and more we encounter shade. If you don't sell your house, if you live in your house long enough, you will be a shade gardener. Shrubs. Among your evergreens, I'm not telling you anything you don't know, yews. Why are yews planted on the north side of every house in America? It's because they will tolerate fairly dense shade. So your Japanese upright yews, don't forget there are two new, fabulous yews, relatively new. Dwarf Bright Gold is a magnificent, it'll get pretty large. It's a yew. You can hack it, you can cut it, you can keep it any size you want. But it comes out with a buttery yellow needle in the spring that stays kind of goldish during the growing season. Dwarf Bright Gold Yew, Nana Orescens, A-U-R-E-S-C-E-N-S, is a low-spreading golden yew. There's a newer variety out now called Novi, which is an upright columnar yew. It grows up kind of like one of those barberries you've seen. Those Hellman pillar barberries, it's very pillar-like. That's Nova, N-O-V-A, Nova yew. So there's some good evergreens. Macrobiata is your unknown, and you can get them in nurseries in the Twin Cities. I can't speak for Eau Claire. Macrobiata, macro, M-A-C-R-O, biota, B-I-O-T-A, Russian cypress is the common name. Northern Pride is the variety, the only variety you will see. And these are a soft shade, dappled sunlight, doesn't like it hot, understory, gorgeous, low spreading evergreen that must be planted in soil that drains well. You can't plant it in clay. You gotta dig a big hole. If you got clay, you gotta dig a big wide hole and dig that thing 20 inches deep and get some good loose organic matter and some sand, and I wouldn't even use the old clay, but I would get something that drains well. So there's some evergreens. Arborvitaes, you know, dear eater, yeah, but you know, people say, oh, arborvitaes, they grow in shade, and you'll see them listed with the half sun, you know, you'll see them listed as part shade. Most arborvitaes, they don't die in shade, but they don't stay full. They don't do well. So you're used. Then when it comes to deciduous shrubs, obviously you got your various viburnums and hydrangeas, and it's up to you to learn those that will take the true low light. It's very difficult. If you're talking dense shade, I mean the worst. North side of the house, long extended eave, full tree canopy, it never gets any direct sunlight, plus it's just a dark area. It's darn tough. Hydrangeas, the dogwood, the new University of Minnesota dogwood, Arctic Sun, has been developed as a true shade dogwood. And it's beautiful. It grows out horizontal. It's got kind of buttery yellow leaves. It doesn't get really tall. It's not a big upright red twig, although it's red twig. Yeah, someone said, oh yeah, did someone grow it or know it? Yeah. Arctic Sun, is it just kind of doing this for you?
Yep.
Just kind of goes out and goes. I've had them in the ground for how tall is yours?
What's that place that I garden?
You're getting her up? Okay, good. I finally have some up to 3 feet. I mean, it just wants to go like that. Clethra is the common forgotten. Clethra, just the way it sounds. That's the common forgotten shade blooming shrub, summer sweet. Is the common name. We're not talking dense shade here, but dappled sunlight, a spot where it gets morning sun, or maybe it just gets a few hours of midday sun, is plenty good for clethra. And there's a bunch of, you know, 16 candles, ruby spice, vanilla spice, hummingbird, there's all sorts, and these flower either white or a ruby pink, and they are extremely fragrant. Summer sweet, plethora. And that would be my short list of good shrubs for shade. Yes, ma'am?
Excuse me, problem. I have a south-facing exposure, and it gets really hot. What kind of dwarf shrubs can I use?
South exposure, really hot. Both the dwarf pines and the dwarf spruce, now we're getting into, I didn't show many of them, but there is a huge world of truly dwarf evergreens. And I'm talking some of them that only grow 2 and 3 feet tall. And now we're getting into the sculptural and the, you know, the spreading and the fabulous. But pretty much all of your dwarf spruce and pine are good for very, very, very hot. Shrub roses. For something that blooms, most of the good Bailey shrub roses, as well as Home Run and Knockout and these various brands they've created, are going to like it hot. Your barberries, which I don't use, I try not to dictate too much to people. I've chosen not to plant barberries anymore. They will be banned eventually. They are banned in some states. These are the Japanese barberries, which unfortunately are all the cool ones. There's various. The Berberis is the genus. There's various varieties, but Japonica, Berberis Japonica is, this is why you got to know your Latin, Berberis Japonica is the one with all the cool ones in it, crimson, you know, pygmy and all of the fabulous red and the oranges. That's all the Japanese barberries, and they're being banned. The berries are just like buckthorn. They're winding up in the woods, and they're growing up. So, but that's your choice. They'll take it hot. You know, think prairie. I mean, for perennials, any prairie-related perennial that we grow now, the rudbeckias and the echinaceas and the leotris, and of course prairie grasses, all your tall grasses. But you know, good hot shrubs would also include nine barks, all your physocarpus nine barks, and there's some beautiful small nine barks. Mugo pine, fabulous. Mugo pine digs it, full sun hot. There's a question here.
Yeah. I need to replant a hemlock tree right now. It's up in the house, kind of, because that's where I was told it would grow. But we need to move it, and we have a lot of sun. Will a hemlock transplant well?
No. How big is it?
It's about 5 feet.
Is it just a Canadian hemlock? It's just growing up into a big evergreen? Or is it some specialty? There's all sorts of specialty dwarf. Well, when you look at it, it looks like a spruce? I mean,
yeah.
Just say yes.
Yeah.
It's a tree.
Yeah.
It's not doing this, and it's not a tiny little thing with gold with silver tips and no, it's a hemlock.
Right.
It's probably a Canadian hemlock.
Right. And they told me to keep trimming it.
Who told you to keep trimming it?
The person that I bought it.
Okay, because you were going to use it near the house.
Right.
So they told you to candle it.
Right.
Every time have you been candling it?
No, but my husband doesn't want it near the house because he's worried that the roots are going to interfere.
All right, how old is it? She has a hemlock near the house. We've ascertained that it's a Canadian hemlock. It's near the house. She wants to move it.
3 years.
Oh, okay. Well, you're probably okay. It'll grow in full sun. Yes. It will. Can you live with it through the summer? Because you either want to do it, you either want to leave right now and go home and do it, or you want to wait until September 8th. All right? Seriously.
What's the magic?
Hey, I'm the expert. Okay. What you're going to do is you're going to dig, you're going to figure out where it goes, and it's going to be in full sun. Okay. That should handle it. The hemlocks are, shade, if you want a big, the shade lady, if you want a big tree in part shade, that's where the hemlocks come in handy. It'll grow in full sun, but you either want to do it right now, you know, this is why, don't get me started, Arbor Day is coming up. All right, remember, this is important, don't plant a tree for Arbor Day, but plant it in September when you're supposed to plant a tree. All right, the people, the politicians, you know, politicians, they don't understand business and they don't understand gardening. So they created our, in the spring when you plant, well, you don't plant trees in there. So that's why I'm saying, you can do it right now while it's dormant. Dig the hole where it's going to go first, and dig a big hole. Dig a 3 foot, 4 foot wide hole, and then keep the soil in there. Then go up to your hemlock, and probably going to use shovels, but starting 3 feet around it. And perennial forks would also work, those stiff things. But you're going to need to dig and have a tarp nearby. You're going to need to slice straight down. You're going to be giving it a bit of a root pruning, but that won't hurt it. And then sometimes you got to dig around it and slice around it. And then outside that slice is where you start digging a trench, a moat, all the way around it. Because ultimately you want to try to get your shovel or something underneath a root ball as big as you can keep, and now you finally have it, and then you and your husband, the two of you, and a third person doesn't hurt, pick that root ball up, and it'll all be falling apart, and there's dirt going everywhere, and you drop it on the tarp, and then you drag the tarp to your hole that's already been dug, and you get it down in there, and you get it in there, because you got to throw dirt in the bottom of your hole so that you're planting it at the same height it was in over there, then you're filling it in with all your soil, and then you're watering the hell out of it right away, all right? If you do it today, you're okay. If not, well, you could do it in the next few weekends.
Okay.
But if not, wait until second week of September.
Okay.
All right? Because you're disturbing the tree. And that's the reason you plant trees in the fall. If you plant a tree in May 1st, what happens? May, June, you got 2 months, you got 60 months before what happens? It's 95 degrees out on the 4th of July. You plant a tree in September after the dog days August heat, and you plant it on the middle of September, now you got the middle of October, the middle of November, the middle of December, where if you mulch that tree, it will grow roots into December. Then it goes dormant. Then along comes April when it wakes up, and then along comes May, April not so much, but along comes May, and then along comes June, and then along comes 95 degrees July, and it's been in the ground, it's been growing roots for at least 5 months, and it can handle the intense stress. So that's why you plant a tree in the fall. Yes?
Any good climbers for an arbor in shade?
Yeah, that's a little tough. Climbers for arbors in shade that bloom. I mean, because Dutchman's, I can never remember. I've never planted it, so I can never remember the true genus. I'm standing here guilty. Look up Dutchman's pipe. Google Dutchman's pipe. There is a perennial variety. It will give you good growth and some bloom in an arbor in shade. Boston ivy will grow just fine. It doesn't bloom whether it's sun or shade. Boston ivy will eventually get up around there. But the wisterias and the clematis and this kind of stuff, the bloomers, they're all full sun. But try Google Dutchman's pipe. See what you think. Yes?
We have a couple of hemlocks that are turning completely brown.
Yeah, it's just a really, really chill. Some hemlocks that are turning brown, and I see a lot of spruce as I drive around, a lot of yews. We just had a really, really, really bitter cold. The single greatest care tip for all evergreens is regular, moderate fall watering straight until the ground freezes. And sometimes we're pretty good about it when the trees are young. And then we kind of, I think it's to be 10, 15 years old, maybe we kind of, after September, it's on its own. Then you run into, I would assume it's the same, we have frost depths in the Twin Cities that were unheard of this winter, or they have to go back to that, I guess it was 1880-something, there was a winter that was worse than this one. But, it might have lacked moisture. The frost got in there really, really deep. And she went
toasty.
Water it well this spring, fertilize it. Brown on an evergreen, brown doesn't go to green. But see if it maybe generates some new life. You know, I'd wait until the middle of, I'd start watering it in May And then I'd certainly be waiting, unless you look at it right now, and it's a white, it's a copper sculpture, I mean, you can tell it's dead. But, you know, I might hold out on it until the end of May. Tough winter. There was, let's do a, is there a back? Have I been ignoring the rear? Yes.
I have a question about how do you feel about when you just created big blue planting bed, which I did last year, convincing your husband that planting for the eventual mature size of the plant is the best thing to do rather than crowding it.
Right, I know. She's planting a bed and she's doing it properly. She's planting with mature width in mind, which is very astute. Because homeowners, that's in my blender talk, they plant, we will think about height, we will ask how tall does it get when we plant, but we often forget how wide does it get, and width is as important as height. So she has planted with mature width in mind, and her husband is giving her some grief about it, because when you're planting, and it depends on the size shrub you buy, but if you're buying number 2, number 3 container, number 5 container, and these are the smaller containers, shrubs, and particularly evergreens, you know, yeah, you're planting something that maybe is eventually going to get 5, 6, 8 feet wide, and you have to plant for that 10-year width. So her husband's giving her grace. Tell him that Don Engebretson, the Renegade Gardener, said you're doing it better than 99% of homeowners. All right? Tell him to go blow off. Tell them to go do something useful. Because you're doing it right. That's very, very astute. Questions up here? Yes, we'll go here, and then we'll go to the person in back.
Vegetables. We're always hearing that we should be doing more, eating more of our landscape. Are mm-hmm. you incorporating a lot more vegetables?
Yeah, I'm doing more vegetable edible now, they call it, edibles. Yeah, and I think it's fabulous, and the key principle there is full sun. Remember, has to be full sun. I guess I can't. Can I go backwards? No. Has to be full sun. That's fish at Madison Square Garden, taken from my seat. It's got to be full sun. It's got to be the sunniest spot. And then, you know, you can go ahead if you have a concept line, if you do have some lawn. Remember, rather than big shrubs here, if this was a sunny spot, south-facing, you can have a vegetable area that's just incorporated into, just like I put the swing set, you know, why couldn't that be the vegetable path with a path all the way around it, divided into, you know, 4-foot sections with a pathway so you can, because then you can reach in 2 feet to harvest and fertilize and mulch, and then you go to the other side and reach in 2 feet. That's why we kind of use a 4-foot width if there's access from both sides. But sure, yeah. I've done a couple of designs for people where it incorporates an edible garden. If the only full sun spot in your yard is the front yard, then you are putting a vegetable patch in your front yard. It need not be a raised timber box, although that's, I have no problem with a raised timber box for a vegetable. It's utilitarian, you know. So, yeah. Now, there are you, ma'am.
Yeah. When you ask for, I will lose all my trees, but I will have sun.
When the what?
When the ash
borer. Oh, yeah, when the ash borer comes. I know, some people are kind of excited. And actually, some people, you know, they'll lose a big tree in a storm, and it's tough. I know, I've lost nice trees in a storm. But then they kind of, and they'll always run into them, and they go, yeah, but on the other hand, you know, all of a sudden they realize their plant palette has expanded because of full sun. Other questions? There were a bunch here, but all right, I'm going to go to you.
How do you incorporate the raised bed into the landscaping?
Well, again, you wouldn't have to. I mean, you could have, let's say there is some lawn present, and then you've got I just did I'll have pictures of it next, because it's the first client I'll be seeing this year. I'm doing their maintenance. In fact, it's the backyard. Remember that really funky stone wall I showed you? It's their backyard. They had, because it's a city lot, they had a funny little L piece. And all I did was I put 5, the Groot Spire Arborvitae as a screen, and then the pathway hooks around. And as you come in there, raised beds, they went out, these two men, they're in their 50s, they went out and bought the mail order raised garden beds that are on feet. You garden standing. And there's an 8-footer, an 8-footer, and an 8-footer. There's 3 of them. But yeah, they're in the land, because they're screened off. You walk, you continue on the pathway that leads out to the alley, you pass the screen, and now you're in the gardening area, which is just this big, it's fence, garage behind you, fence with gate to the alley, perimeter fence, 3 raised boxes, the whole thing is just a mulch floor. So you can hide it, you can shield it, but also, if you've got a curving concept line in the sunny spot, and you've done it with really nice shrubs or trees or something, so what if when you step in there, now you're in a mulched area that has raised vegetable beds in the timber, that's, you know, is that different from a square sandbox? Questions? Yes, in the back.
How do you get moles that are ruining your bed?
Moles, with an M, and we know they're moles, not bowls.
I believe that.
Because a mole will usually, then you'll see a mound,
yeah.
You'll see a bigger hole, dollar size, and often the runner, okay, because bowls are also rough. The best thing to do with moles is to trap them and kill them with spring traps. And you want to go to the website of my buddy Jeff Holper, H-O-L-P-E-R, and just Google the mole hunter. The mole hunter. Jeff lives in St. Louis. He runs a pest extermination company. I bump into him all the time when I'm out speaking on the Home and Garden Show and Flower Show circuit around the country in the winter. He, almost every year, I'll be at a show and I go, Jeff's in Pittsburgh this year too with me. Because he gives a wonderful talk, and I've sat through it 1,000 times, on killing moles. And his website, he consulted with a company as the design expert and built the superior mole trap, because the ones he was buying at hardware stores and the other ones, even American made, weren't proficient, had some flaws. So he actually designed a superior trap. The key to it is people don't set enough traps. They don't learn how to identify an active run. They set a less than proficient trap improperly, and they don't kill any moles. He will sell you he sells traps on the website, comes with a CD that explains how to go about controlling and killing the moles in your property, and then he even has a page on it where when you're done, he wants a picture of you holding your mole, and then he posts it on his website. So, but he, and his talk, the poisons, the scents, the vibration, he debunks virtually every other mole deterrent that is out there and looks you in the eye and says, if you want to get rid of the moles, you have to kill them. And you kill them with traps, and here's how. There was a question here.
No, I have a lot of moles in my yard as well, and I was probably getting about, I don't know, 3 or 4 a week.
That's good.
Yeah, and I've got this great trap. I've had a lot of people ask me about it.
It's a plunge trap, right? You cock it?
Yep.
Spring trap?
And what I like about it is called the Easy Mole Eliminator. And I don't want to bring it out of the ground and get something dead out of it. So all I do is I cock it, I step on it again, and then it releases the mole, and I pull the trap out, and then I just camp down.
Oh.
You don't want to
see the consequence of your action.
No,
do you?
All underground.
Questions? Voles. Voles with a V. Voles are more common. Moles are not that common. You guys are still 4, aren't you? Or did they reclassify you to 5?
No.
Zone 5. They kept you in 4, didn't they?
For sure.
Yeah. Moles are not, boy, we're lucky. You live down in, I mean, when I'm speaking around the country, the farther south I get, the more I'm likely to be on a stage with Jeff, because we're lucky. I don't think I've ever seen a mole in my yard, although they're common, but this is the northern range. Voles, which are really a mouse, a form of mice, they're troublesome too, and I just had a vole outbreak in a client's, and they love new landscapes because the soil generally has been disrupted and it's easy for them. And and they also like mulches because they're not moles who are designed to dig tunnels through the earth. They're more right on the top. They like to go just underneath the turf grass. They like to go just underneath the shredded hardwood mulch where it's easy going. And the only thing I've found that work are the poisons, and I can't even find them in hardware stores, and Fleet Farm used to sell them. I go online, and I spend $40, $50, and they send you like an ice cream tub, and it's just bowl pellets, and I buy those Glad, not even Tupperware, just the smallest little Glad. They come stacked, about 8 of them, just little food keepers with a little blue lid. And I just take a sharp knife or something and I just cut mouse holes into both ends and I throw the bait in there and then I just place those around all the places that I'm seeing the bowl. And a bowl hole will be more quarter size, very small hole, quarter size, and they will go down into the dirt. So I'm sprinkling it in there. Got to think about children, pets. Dogs are smart. Dogs sniff around there and they go, oh boy, that's poison. I mean, you know, it's not as horrible as you might think. But and then the mineral oil, the oil-based deterrents do work pretty well. So you might do those in combination, and you've really got to limit that. You remember, you're using mineral oil. It's just like, you know, the organic yoo-hoos who are, you know, oh, horticultural oil, you know, for organic gardening. Yeah, you know, it's petroleum oil. There's about 18 synthetic chemicals that are a lot safer for the environment than horticultural oils that are approved for organic gardening, but don't get me started. But there's a poison. There's a poison you can buy. Check your different reasonry. Maybe your Menards in your good or Menards here in Menards land sell a decent one. They stopped selling Home Depot and everything. I can't get the Volt poison anymore, so I order it online.
I know we've caught
mousetrap. Oh yeah, no, and I should have mentioned because I've got a number of people I know who have set up mousetrap. What did you use for bait?
Apple.
Apple. Okay. Yeah, no, they've said, oh, we control them with
turnover, like flower pot, put the trap under it with the apple.
And he comes in because they can probably smell it.
Yeah.
Very cool. Did you hear that? You take the flower pot, you put the mouse trap down, put the flower top on top of it, the vole will smell the apple and tunnel in from underneath, or he'll probably just go right underneath the thing. Good idea. More questions? Yes.
Deer eat hydrangeas?
Yeah. Well, deer eating anything, what do you do? You know, what's that? Liquid fence is a very good one. Deer proof, deer off. The chemical sprays get better and better. You do have to repeat them. I recommend if you're going to be using a spray, spray once a week, even if it doesn't rain. Just the stuff wears out, it loses its scent, the dew, as we start getting into dew, you know, you say, well, it hasn't rained in a week. Well, there's dew on the leaves and where you've sprayed, and that breaks it down. There's products now, I think it's orgon.com, O-R-G-O-N, if I'm not mistaken, orgon.com. They sell a very effective deer-proofing scent that comes in a plastic green canister that you hang. It comes in a little thing that you hang. And it lasts for a month. Rain doesn't have anything to do with it because it's inside of this little green shell, plastic shell. So you can hang these around. But It's just a case of people going out and spraying once or twice for deer, and then they kind of give up on it. No, you gotta set your perimeter. There's some wonderful products now. You can Google just deer. I would Google, because I can't think of the name of a manufacturer. It might be Have a Heart, but static shock deer repellent. They make a, it's just a slender, stiff wire, and on it is, again, sort of a plastic green and red, kind of looks like a little flower, and there's a watch battery inside there. And you place these on the perimeter, but you don't do one. You learn, where are the deer accessing my yard? You define your perimeter. Now you start spraying. Now you stick 12 of these out. And when the deer comes up, they're attracted to it, and when they touch it with their nose or lick it, it gives them a static shock like you get from a car door, and the deer just rear up. So it's a combination. But of course, fencing, perimeter fencing, 7-foot perimeter fencing, and dogs are the best possible deer repellents. It does, but it doesn't work as well as sprays. You know, why be going to that excess when they've got? But the urine sprays, the egg sprays, these are quite effective. But you got to keep up with them. Nothing beats a dog in the yard. Yes. In a huge garden, how do you deter weeds? Mulch. You know, and don't mulch. People, they use cocoa bean husk, which I think is fine around perennials. If you don't, you know, if the smell isn't too strong, chocolate isn't too strong for you. But they'll lay it down in a quarter inch. You know, you need 3 inches, whether you're using shredded hardwood or husks or what have you. Get down a good 3-inch layer, that of whatever organic mulch you're using. That will block all sunlight from germinating weed seeds in the soil. The weeds that you get are airborne. They float in, and then they germinate in the mulch. And they germinate in rock, if you've ever had a house with river rock around it. Oh, black plastic and river rock. They say, oh, you'll never have to weed. Well, 2-3 years later, there's a soil on top of that that's developed just from the soil in the air. You know, I've got pictures of maple trees growing out of rock mulch. So you just have big landscapes. How do you keep the weeds down?